Give me la dolce vita, hot music.
I'm Jimmy Peterson, born in the United States, resident of Austria, citizen of the world. BA in history, master's in education, followed by more than 40 years of ski bumming, street music, and travel. But hey, Dad, don't fret about my poor resume. I've met many people, made a lot of friends, skied more than 4,000 days on all seven continents, and I've come away with quite a few interesting stories to tell.
I'm traveling free. I wanna travel free.
Did you know that communist philosopher Leon Trotsky was murdered in 1945 with an ice axe by a Stalin-appointed assassin while residing in Mexico City? Did you know that Mexican painter Frida Kahlo got very little recognition during her lifetime, but that Madonna bought her self-portrait with monkey for $1 million? Did you know that the world's richest man from 2010 to 2013 was the telecom magnate and Mexican citizen Carlos Slim? Did you know that about 46% of Mexico's population live in poverty, defined by the government agency Coneval as living on less than $158 a month in the city or less than $98 a month in a rural environment? Did you know that 55% of what was once Mexico is now part of the United States as a result of the Mexican-American War and the War of Texas Independence? Did you know that the Acapulco cliff divers dive about 35 meters from the La Quebrada cliffs into water which varies from about 2 to 5 meters in depth, depending on the timing of the waves? Did you know that the legendary Battle of the Alamo was fought because Mexico had abolished slavery and the American settlers to Texas had come primarily from the South and wanted to preserve that institution they loved so dearly? Did you know that the last German-produced Volkswagen Beetle rolled off the assembly line in 1980, while the legendary model continued to be manufactured in Mexico until 2003? And did you know that one can ski in Mexico?
This is an awesome view of Popocatépetl with new snow from last night on the peak. My grandfather lived in Mexico in Cuernavaca from the 1940s till his death in about the mid-50s. And my first introduction to Popocatépetl was photos from my mother.
It was with those early photos that the first seed was planted in my young brain about snow and the possibility to ski in Mexico. Four somewhat demented friends joined me to pursue this loco idea. Jan-Erik Bloomberg, like myself, is a professional skier and journalist. Papi Tuomala, Eric Olson, and Gary Pan are all businessmen who live in Washington, D.C. Jan-Erik and I have worked with skiing most of our adult lives, while the three from Washington are basically weekend warriors, looking for something exciting to liven up their businessman's daily routines. I concocted this trip to Mexico with the purpose of skiing on Mount Iztaccíhuatl. But that was not the only goal. We also came in search of the real Mexico. I had seen and heard the views of the President of the United States.
They're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists.
The history class version and the Hollywood myth version.
But he does know the short way to start a war.
And you will always remember the Alamo.
But what is the true heart and soul of Mexico?
I grew up in the era before political correctness. Where I was raised in Southern California, we called Mexicans beaners, and they called us gringos. What I didn't know was that Mexicans generally like gringos. Actually, there was very little that I did know about Mexico and Mexicans when I was younger.
It's so easy for people to get misconceptions about other countries and the people from those countries, and happens most often with countries that neighbor one another. Growing up in Southern California, my impression of Mexico was made by Tijuana. That was a place where us under 21s went to go drinking, where it was, I don't know if it was legal or if they just let us do it. And many of us had our first experiences with women of ill repute. Even a Mexican would say Tijuana is a shithole. But for us, it was Mexico. Here's the story the way the Kingston Trio portrayed it of Tijuana.
We went one day, about a month ago, to have a little fun in Mexico. We ended up in the gambling spa, where the liquor flowed and the dice were hot. So here we are in the Tijuana jail, ain't got no friends to go our bail, so here we'll stay.
Well, my Tijuana experiences were way back around 1970. That was then, and this is 45 years later, as I try to discover the real Mexico.
Here is my father. My father and my brother, Moises.
Hi, I'm Jimmy.
It's my guy too. You're going to be with him at the mountain.
Okay.
Lilies.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And him.
Hello,
Jimmy. Mountain guy too. Yeah.
How many brothers and sisters are there?
We are eight brothers and sisters, and my father and my mom.
Is this your mother?
Yes, it's my mother when he's youngest.
Oh. Buenos dias.
Oh, buenos dias.
¿Cómo se llama?
Berta.
Berta.
Berta Reyes de Vidales.
Jimmy, Jaime para español.
Jaime. Oh, bonito nombre.
Gracias. Mucho gusto.
Is that breakfast for me?
Yes, of course.
Great.
You're welcome.
I'm starving.
Yeah. Remember, the tu casa es mi casa. So that's mean my home is your home.
The way you treat your family, if I'm part of the family, then I feel as good as could be.
I have a little problem.
What's up?
My button has come off. Is that something you know how to fix?
Yeah, I have a needle. I can sew it.
That would be great.
Yeah, just wait a second. What happened? Mexican food? Too many?
No, hey, come on. Wait a minute. I'm here to be on a diet. That's where we're going hiking. That's my diet.
Not meant to offend. Just asking.
I did have a lot of, taco chips and guacamole last night.
I'm staying here for a while. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm helping my grandmother to take care of my grandfather.
Guillermo and Hilarion Vidales, the two brothers who founded a trekking company some years back, both live a middle-class lifestyle by Mexican standards. But it was not always so. Hilarion shared some of the family history with me.
My grandfather come from Guerrero. The mother of my father died when he was a child, so they have to walk to come to Mexico, like 600 kilometers to come here.
With his wife dead, Hilarion's grandfather could not both work and take care of three young children. The purpose of his 600-kilometer odyssey on foot to Mexico City was to bring the kids to an orphanage. One of the children died en route. But Granddad survived and got a better education and better opportunities at the orphanage than he would have had otherwise. He became a teacher, but still the life was not easy. Altogether, they were eight siblings, and the home had no running water. Every day, Dad and all the kids carried water 1 kilometer to the house.
Now, there are a lot of pollution. In the past, you see the mountains, for example, Popocatépetl and Iztaccíhuatl, and was very incredible feeling to see the from the highest points.
We're here
on a mountain in the middle of Mexico City called Cerro de la Estrella, the Mountain of the Stars. If you look at this here, you'll see that as it portrays the times hundreds of years ago, there was permanent snow on both Popocatépetl and Mount Ista. Nowadays, of course, that is long in the past. There's a small glacier left on Mount Ista, the one that one could still ski on. So, Hilarion, when was the first time that you were up on the top of Mount Iztaccíhuatl?
Oh, in Ista, in 1977.
How much has it changed to the present day?
Yes, too much, because especially when you cross the glacier, it's the stomach of the sleepy lady, or the Iztaccíhuatl, and you cross the glacier like this, and there were a lot of crevasses, so you have to use ropes and more gear, like ice tools. And now, when you get this part, you have to go down and up. Yeah.
You're a believer in climate change. You've seen that there is a lot of global warming in the last 40 years.
Yeah, I saw how the mountain changed.
What do you call this kind of flower?
Ah, we call Noche Buenas.
I've never seen a tree like this. We buy them in the store, you know, in one flower in a pot, and it costs like $10. So I mean, this thing is worth about a few thousand dollars. This is a gold mine.
You have strong arms.
Sí.
Mucho fuerte. ¿Cuántos naranja tú este en una día?
Como 200.
200. I need to get one of these for my house.
I love Chuck Berry. Chuck Berry.
Well, in the morning, I'm giving you my morning. Don't you step on my blue suede shoes. Hey, little, I'm playing my fiddle. Ain't got nothing to lose. Roma Beethoven, they'll check ask you the news. Roma Beethoven, roll over Beethoven, roll over Beethoven, roll over Beethoven, roll over Beethoven, he's rhythm and blues.
Oh yeah.
I always sing this song with my son in our band.
Wow.
Yeah. This is a beautiful Catholic church, but it always strikes me how in these poor countries, the poorest people give what little they have to the richest institution. Coyoacan is a picturesque part of Mexico City that has for a long time been home to an intellectual and artistic crowd. It's been to Mexico City what the left bank was to Paris in the 1920s.
Me siento feliz y contento con ustedes cantándoles. Ahí quedó mis patrones. Muchas gracias y provecho. Felicidades. Gracias.
So, Hilarion, what's the real Mexico for you?
Yeah, Mexico, it's to feel how the Mexican live, how the Mexican testing food, for example. Now we are in one of the most famous corners in Mexico. We are in Coyoacán, in Café Jarocho. It's famous and delicious, the coffee here.
Coffee is a big part of the Mexican culture.
Yes, coffee is a very important thing in Mexico. It's funny because in the past, just the poor people drink coffee because the rich people drink milk, you know? It's interesting, but now I guess it's different. You know, when you have a girlfriend, for example, and you don't have a lot of money, you come here and you
buy the coffees. So everybody's happy because testing very good and the price is good too.
The places the tourists go. Tell me about Cancun. That's the most popular American tourist destination in Mexico.
If you want to have experience to know the real Mexico, it's not the best place, of course. You have more things, especially in Mexico City and other towns around Mexico City too.
Former home of painters Frida Kahlo and her husband Diego Rivera is today a museum. As a result of both polio and a trolley car accident, Frida spent much of her life in great pain. Despite 35 operations, uncomfortable corsets were part of her daily wardrobe. Her pain was often expressed in her self-portraits.
Frida and Diego. Diego was an unbelievable philanderer, had affairs with many women. Of course, I never did that as a ski bum. He didn't really look very much, and when he had an affair with Frida's sister, that was more emotional torture for her in addition to her physical torture.
Frida was also not a faithful wife. She had regular affairs with both sexes. One of her partners was Leon Trotsky, the Marxist philosopher who had been one of the leaders of the Russian Revolution. In the late 1930s, he was living in exile in Coyoacan, a neighbor to Frida and Diego.
Leon Trotsky spent the last couple years of his life in Mexico City. He came to Mexico on invitation from Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, who interceded with the president of Mexico to allow him to come here. This is his garden where he lived the last couple of years of his life. He was hunted along with all of his family by Stalin, who was afraid of their differences in philosophy. Check out this iron door, but it didn't stop the assassins from trying to get Trotsky. This is all bullet holes from the first assassination attempt in 1940. In August 1940, Ramon Mercader del Rio, hired by Joseph Stalin, got to Trotsky with an ice axe while he was sitting at this desk, and that was the end of Leon Trotsky. Guillermo, is there going to be this much snow on the mountain?
This is a very good question. We need to make a lot of margaritas in the glacier. 30 years ago, the tequila was the cheaper drink in Mexico. It was only the drink for the workers. So it was very strong. So after work, the workers feel really strong the tequila flavor, so they use the lemon and salt for don't feel too strong the flavor. Now we have more tequilas. Now it's famous for the foreigners. But 30 years ago was the most cheaper drink of tequila in Mexico, cost almost $1 the liter. Molcajete.
Molcajete.
It's a volcanic stone, and the Aztec make the salsa here and crush all the tomatoes, chili peppers, and the flavor is very good with you making the molcajete. It's better than the machine, of course.
Oh, I'm sure. It looks great, but probably I would have diarrhea for about a week if I had some of that.
Well, this is too spicy, so it's for Mexican stomachs, of course.
The following day, we did an acclimatization hike on Mount La Malinche. Everybody felt good at 4,000 meters. It was all systems go for our ski expedition. The only condition that was less than perfect was the weather.
As usual, I'm dead last.
The upper mountain of La Malinche was shrouded in a cloud and the air was drizzly. We could only hope for better weather for the main event. The mountain is usually my altar. But without any mountains right here in Mexico City, this will have to do. Please bring us back safely from Mount Iztaccíhuatl tomorrow. This is sunrise on Popocatépetl, but it's the morning before our trek. We would begin at 1:30 the following morning on Iztaccíhuatl. From this angle, one sees the new fallen snow, but not the glacier, which is tucked into the valley between the two peaks. Gary is clearly ready.
This is a breakfast of champions, Coca-Cola and a little piece of cheese.
After 2 days with no sleep because of the altitude, and I have difficulty sleeping at altitude, I don't have much clever to say, to be honest. You know, I just hope that, you know, we make it okay, that nobody gets altitude sick, because that's always a question.
I'm going to go so slow, I might not make it by sunset, let alone sunrise. This is... Sadly, maybe an opportunity that won't be around for much longer. I suppose this glacier might disappear within our lifetime.
The mountain to the top takes like 8 hours. At the half of it, it's the hut at 4,780 meters.
We're at 4,200 meters now. We've made the first 300 meters in a little over an hour. And we see the beautiful sprawling lights of Mexico City down below. We're at the hut at about 4,800 meters. It's cold. I'm cold. I'm wet. I'm frozen. I'm miserable. It's crowded. Nobody will close the door because people are going in and out seeking refuge. And I really wonder if we're going to make it. The weather report is not good. It's snowing lightly. But I just feel frozen through and through.
By morning, even down in the valley, the wind had picked up. And up on the mountain, it was really howling and unpleasant. After reaching an elevation of close to 5,000 meters, and not really that far from the glacier, some of us decided to turn back. Papi, Jan Erik, and myself headed back down, while Erik and Gary continued with our lead guide, Pablo.
Prudence is often the better part of valor, and today we got up to 5,000 meters, a little under that. We hoped to get to 5,200 about. We had to turn back, but still, I think we did the right thing. The mountain is like a beautiful woman. It can inspire you beyond belief sometimes, and the next moment, it's fickle-hearted and leaves you flat.
Once we parted ways with Erik, Gary, and Pablo, There was no way for us to get any information about their continued attempt until late that night. We hoped that at least part of our party would achieve the goal of skiing in Mexico. The two weekend warriors still were upbeat with plenty of energy and enthusiasm when we left them.
We're about to head back on the road.
Right.
Only 3 hours left.
I can't believe you dragged me all the way over here. Olsen, a long adventure to ski in Mexico. Aquí estamos. All right, Gary, make some turns.
We had to go all the way out to the glacier. Unbelievable.
Turn the turn. Bravo, bravo. Bien hecho.
I survived. We came to Mexico. We came and conquered.
Bien hecho.
They didn't summit the peak, but they did reach the snow. Unfortunately, Eric's boots were so frozen that he was unable to get them on. That left only one, Gary Pan, to make a few ugly turns and glean some success for our mission. The following day, our secondary goal of discovering the real Mexico continued, in Xochimilco, a historic suburb of Mexico City, built on the shores of a lake with the same name. The Spanish began draining the lake way back in the early 1600s, and today, what once was a 350 square kilometer body of water is down to 25 square kilometers in the form of canals. A UNESCO World Heritage Site, Xochimilco is popular among locals and tourists alike who ride around on brightly painted boats called trajineras. Our travels continued, this time to Acapulco. Once a major tourist destination for the jet set, today the city has the ignominious distinction of being the fourth most dangerous city in the world, a result of the Mexican drug cartels that are based in this region.
The tradition of the cliff diving in Acapulco started in the 30s. My mom and dad came here in the 40s and 50s, and that's where I first heard about it. But every star of Hollywood for generations came here. The bar of the Mirador Hotel is lined with autographs, Frank Sinatra, Elizabeth Taylor, Sammy Davis Jr. They were all here. Elvis filmed Fun in Acapulco in the 60s. This was the place to come for the Hollywood stars. And I thought, once in my life, I gotta come here also and check it out. It's a different side of Mexico, for sure.
The beaches are still beautiful and the water is the same lovely turquoise that it was in its heyday, but the tourism today is mostly limited to middle-class Mexicans. We're at about 2,000 meters above Taxco, where the Jesus Christ monument is. It's maybe not quite as big as the one in Rio, but it's pretty impressive. And the view out over Taxco is as well. Taxco was a silver mining town. The silver is more or less run out, but it still is a place for the artisans who mold the silver and lots of shops that sell it. But nowadays, Taxco is a place that lives mostly on tourism. Guillermo suggested that we might find something of the real Mexico in Taxco, a beautiful colonial town with narrow cobblestone streets adorned by bougainvillea trees and potted geraniums. The town center is dominated by the Baroque Santa Prisha Church, which stands head and shoulders above all the surrounding buildings. There were no modern high-rise hotels as in most of the famous beach resorts, and the colonial architecture gave Taxco a sense of the real Mexico. We're here at the largest pyramid in Mexico, Teotihuacan. It's the Pyramid of the Sun. And it was built about 2,400 years ago by the Teotihuacan people. Later, other groups lived here. That whole tribe of people more or less disappeared. And later, the Aztec culture, of course, rose to power in Mexico. So now we're just around the top of the Pyramid Teotihuacan, the Sun Pyramid, and it's a fantastic 360-degree view. Mexico City is off in this direction where you see the haze, but out here we're maybe 60 kilometers away from the city, and there's no trace of pollution here. Beautiful blue skies. You can really take a deep breath and feel good. Interestingly enough, the explanations on all of the descriptions here are in Nahuatl, which is the Aztec language, as well as in Spanish and English.
I was down to my last day in Mexico, and there was one more thing left on my to-do list, a bullfight. While I find the sport to be extremely cruel and inhumane, I had never seen this spectacle, and my curiosity won the day. The Plaza Mexico, which holds 40,000 spectators, is the world's largest bull ring.
We gotta get ourselves one of these for the ski slopes. A bota bag is what this was called. I used to have this as a kid. Have your wine with you on the slopes.
Immediately upon arriving at the ring, long before the event began, I understood that this tradition was a sort of folk festival. Like so much of Mexico, it's full of color and tradition. People congregated outside the arena hours before the fight. While I watched the bullfight, I was struck by a metaphor. One could hardly avoid the comparison between the proud matador and the Mexican's pride in his Spanish heritage. Yet facing off with the arrogant and aloof matador was the poor bull, equally proud and yet doomed to fail in this mismatch with the matador and his team of banderilleros and picadores, with weapons and horses at their disposal. Is the bull not similar to the proud but undermatched Aztecs, unable to overcome the advantage that horses and firearms gave to the Spanish conquistadores? A Mexican is not only proud of his Spanish heritage, he's equally appreciative of his noble Aztec origins. There was something about this unusual sport that got to the core of the enigma that epitomizes today's Mexican. An odd mixture of the pride and inferiority complex rooted in the historic interbreeding of the two races and cultures. As an American, I immediately saw yet one more metaphor. Were the two mismatched adversaries locked in the arena together not similar to the two neighbors, the United States and Mexico? One of the two has an arsenal of wealth and weaponry that will forever allow its will to prevail, while the other stands in close proximity, proud but naked, and doomed to a foregone conclusion. As the sun was setting on Plaza Mexico and on my Mexican visit, yet one more analogy popped into my head. As with bullfighting, ski mountaineering pits man against nature. Still, there's a big difference between the two. The mountain and the mountaineer live in symbiosis. If I had succeeded to ski on Iztaccíhuatl, the mountain would still stand tall and proud despite my conquest. There does not have to be a loser. In Mexico, I failed, but I still hiked back down unscathed. By contrast, in a bullfight, the bull is invariably the loser, and sometimes the matador as well.
Ready now to depart my host country, I felt like a winner. I discovered some of the real Mexico in various regions during our trip. But most of all, I had discovered the heart and soul of the country in the generous hospitality of our hosts, Guillermo, Hilarion, and their family. The real Mexico is not a city, a market, or a sporting event. It's a nation of people.
Give me la dulce vita, hot music and señoritas. Don't give me convention and job security. Give me la dulce vita, good bourbon and margarita. Good food, fine wine, fast women, and travel in